Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Ruth Institute Summit for Survivors of the Sexual Revolution, being broadcast live from Lake Charles, Louisiana. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, the founder and president of the Ruth Institute, and we're delighted that you're watching. If you're live streaming now, you can comment on our Facebook page in real time. And if you're watching a video after the fact, we're delighted about that as well. Our first speaker this morning is Dr. Stephen Baskerville, who is a professor of government and politics at Patrick Henry College in Virginia. Dr. Baskerville, in my opinion, is the most important theorist of no-fault divorce in our country today and probably anywhere in the world. Dr. Baskerville has thought through the question of what does it mean when the state creates an institution of unilateral no-fault divorce. And so he is going to speak with us today on the subject of how no-fault divorce empowers the state. Please welcome Dr. Stephen Baskerville.
Kind introduction. Can you hear me? Yes, sounds like you can. Thank you. Yes, and thank you for the invitation to speak here today. I'm very honored. I started this because I found that very few people had ever really analyzed the divorce, no-fault divorce phenomenon from a political perspective, someone with a background in politics. And so this was my endeavor to try and understand the politics behind the cliches. The destructive power of divorce is well known in many ways, of course. The pain and trauma it causes children, the social costs to our society, and the financial costs to all of us. It is by far the most direct threat to the integrity and survival of the family. Less well known is how unilateral and involuntary divorce, no fault, expands government power. In fact, it is the principal engine driving the expansion of the domestic state machinery. This is a strong statement, but it can easily be proven. There are several reasons for this. These three that I will talk about are the most important. First, and most important of all, it constitutes a radical innovation in the legal system and principles of legal justice. It rationalizes and permits unprecedented state intrusion into the private sphere of life and the violation of basic constitutional rights. And I will talk about this one the most. Secondly, though, it is the main incubator of social pathologies that rationalize increased government measures and government power in response. And third, it is the main source and font of almost all other political and legal innovations in the sexual revolution. Unilateral and involuntary divorce is the most radical legal innovation ever undertaken in the English-speaking democracies. It departs from the most basic principles of the common law, limited government, and Bill of Rights, and more. Yet no public debate was ever held on these innovations, either before they were implemented or since. First, it violates the ancient common law principle that a legally unimpeachable citizen has the right to be left in peace by the state. In no other area of the law, so far, can a citizen be accused of no legal infraction, either criminal or civil, be summoned to court and issued with directives controlling his life for which he can then be punished. And further, these directives control the most intimate and private corners of his life, his right to be with his own children and his relationship with them, his right to reside in his own home, his right to his own property, his private conversations, and his external movements. Failure to observe these directives can and does result in incarceration without trial. Divorce proceedings are the only legal proceeding, again, so far, with a predetermined outcome, as Jenny pointed out yesterday. A divorce must be and always is granted. Divorce elevates the will of the plaintiff to the level and force of law itself. If all that is required for the court to act against the defendant is a finding that a marriage has, quote, irrevocably broken down, then the plaintiff's complaint is true by virtue of being stated. The objective fact that the plaintiff is thereby breaking a legal contract is ignored and replaced by the subjective power of the plaintiff to turn a personal preference into a legal fact. And as we shall see, this is very important. So divorce courts are not really courts at all. They are merely administrative agencies that automatically implement a predetermined administrative procedure. Principles of justice, violations of law, rules of evidence, none of these can or do have any impact on the basic outcome. Thus, unlike true courts, the principal concern of divorce courts is not to weigh or administer justice. the very concept of no-fault justice is a contradiction in terms. It is not possible to dispense justice without considerations of fault. If the marriage contract has been breached, then someone has breached it, if only by filing for divorce without any legal grounds. And once the courts stop dispensing justice, they start dispensing injustice. There's really no third option. If children are involved, the courts immediately assume control over them and routinely deprive one or both parents of contact with and authority over them, even if one parent has not committed any legal infraction and is blameless. Thus, one parent can surrender both parents' custody rights over the children. No burden of proof requires the state to justify why. The burden of proof and the financial burden falls upon the parent to justify why his children should be returned. This is all contrary to centuries of common law precedent that parents have an inviolable and even a sacred and inherent natural right, in the words of one decision, to the care and custody of their children and to speak for their welfare, unless they have committed some legal transgression that warrants losing this right. This is all overturned by the best interest of the child, the principle governing child custody and increasingly other matters too. This formula transfers control of children, all children, even those not involved in divorce proceedings, from parents to state functionaries. Like no-fault divorce itself, child custody decisions have nothing to do with justice. Thus, a legally unimpeachable parent can suddenly be arrested for seeing his own children without government authorization. He can then be arrested for failure or inability to obey additional judicial directives that apply to no one but him. The child support system routinely forces legally innocent parents not only to surrender their children, but to pay those who have taken them, directly violating the common law principle that a financial obligation must be based on some positive act by which the citizen incurs it. Otherwise, it is a license to plunder innocent people. The very involvement of the judiciary, with its handmaid, the penal apparatus, indicates how involuntary marriage dissolution blurs the distinction between innocence and guilt. When government stopped enforcing the marriage contract, it started enforcing the divorce decree. The result was not the removal of the state from family life, but an explosion of intrusive government machinery whose sole purpose was intervention in families. No-fault divorce permits the state, in the person of a single judge, and at the sole request of one spouse, to assume jurisdiction over the private lives of citizens who are minding their own business and turn otherwise lawful private acts into behavior into punishable acts. Previously, a citizen could only be incarcerated following a conviction by a jury of his peers for violating a statutory law passed with public input by elected legislators that applied equally to all. Suddenly, a citizen could be arrested and jailed without trial for failing to conform his private life to an order issued in a matter of minutes from limited information by an unelected judge that applied to no one but himself, and whose provisions might very well be impossible for him to obey. So in effect, a personalized criminal code is legislated ad hoc around the individual by a judge, subjecting him to arrest for doing what anyone else may lawfully do. The involuntarily divorced spouse becomes a kind of vassal of the judge, who may simply order him to do what he or she pleases. The implications of all this extend well beyond family law. Okay? A very fundamental shift here has taken place in the power of government over private life, without the slightest opposition or even notice, and certainly without any debate. These methods are spreading and becoming available for use against other Americans, poisoning our larger judicial system. So defenders of the family have seriously underestimated the destructive power of divorce for both families and freedom. Before proceeding further, I want to make a brief digression from the legal to the social, because involuntary divorce also breeds social pathologies that rationalize government measures. Since the 1960s, we have been warned about a growing crisis of single-parent homes and fatherless children. Initially, this concerned mostly low-income families in the inner cities, but now it has expanded to the affluent and threatens our larger society. Some 24 million American children, or about 33%, live in households without their fathers. For African-American children, the figure is about 67%. No successful human society has ever been based on the mother-child dyad or in any structure other than the married two-parent family. And so much has been written on this in recent years that it hardly needs to be labored. Virtually every social pathology in the industrialized countries, violent crime, drug and alcohol abuse, truancy, scholastic failure, unwed pregnancy, suicide, other pathological disorders, all these correlate more strongly to single-parent homes and to fatherlessness than to any other factor. The overwhelming majority of prisoners, juvenile detention inmates, high school dropouts, pregnant teenagers, adolescent murderers, and rapists all come from fatherless homes. Fatherlessness eclipses both poverty and race as predictors of criminality and other antisocial behavior. Children from affluent but separated families are more likely to get into trouble than poor children from intact families, and white children from separated families are at greater risk than black children in intact families. So the connection between single-parent households and crime erases the relationship between race and crime and between low income and crime. All these pathologies, by the way, make a claim on governments and our finances. To deal with them, governments must expand their scope, power, and expenditure, and of course, our taxation. Broken homes are the main cause of skyrocketing government budgets for crime and incarceration, truancy, education, healthcare, and of course, ever-expanding social services. All this is widely known, and it's unrefuted, by the way. What is not widely known is the reason. Okay, these broken homes are not created through paternal abandonment or divorce by mutual consent. Some 80% of divorces are unilateral and without established legal grounds, and that figure is higher almost certainly when children are involved. Okay, these problems are created by unilateral and involuntary divorce, no-fault divorce, which allows one parent to deprive children of both parents. It invites collusion between the divorcing spouse and the government. Divorce today is less likely to be a reasoned mutual decision than a power grab by one spouse, assisted by lawyers, judges, and others who profit from the system. So by extending the reach of the state over children and the forcibly divorced parent, unilateral divorce has turned children into weapons of both parental and governmental power. With fatherlessness stubbornly but falsely attributed to paternal abandonment, the only government response becomes ever more draconian measures against allegedly dissolute fathers. Because fathers were never the main cause of the problem in the first place, these measures do not ameliorate the problem. In fact, they make it much worse. If instead we see single parenthood as the intentional and avowed choice of the sexual revolution, then the explosion of crime, addiction, and other problems, and with it the massive increase in the size and power of the state, and the penal system just in particular, takes on increased significance. And it is far from fanciful to suggest that sexual liberation lies behind the larger trends in violent crime and incarceration, as well as other major social ills. So I want to return now to the legal a little more. Few people stopped to consider the implications of laws that shifted the breakup of private households from a voluntary to an involuntary process. Okay, involuntary divorce, by its nature, requires constant supervision over private life by state officials. Most Americans are shocked when they find out what goes on today under the name of divorce. Divorce now licenses the power to evict innocent citizens from their homes, to seize their children, confiscate their property, and jail them without trial. Comprised of family courts and federally funded social service bureaucracies that wield police powers, the divorce machinery has become the most repressive sector of government power ever created in the United States. Though the divorce courts reside at the bottom of the judicial hierarchy, they have some of the most sweeping powers. And moreover, their own rulings consistently give themselves yet more power. The courts, having successfully asserted the power to take children from legally innocent parents, other violations of basic constitutional rights and civil liberties flow just naturally and almost inexorably, as much as one lie necessitates another. In fact, one can run point by point down the Bill of Rights and other articles, and there's hardly one that is not routinely violated by the divorce courts, and that's precisely what I'm going to do. The First Amendment, for example, family courts routinely control what parents may say and do with their children, including what religious worship they may or must attend, and what subjects they may discuss in private. Courts routinely issue gag orders, criminalizing parents for what they say in public, and against newspapers prohibiting publication. In many jurisdictions, it is a crime to criticize family court judges and otherwise discuss family law cases publicly. Judges have prohibited the distribution of books and other literature, impounded documents, and shut down internet sites. Parents who join public protests have been taken into custody for psychological evaluation. And yet family courts also publish their own documents, political documents, attacking parents and other citizens who are given no right to reply in their own defense. The Fourth Amendment protects the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures. Yet without warrants, parents are routinely ordered to surrender not only their children, but diaries, notebooks, correspondence, financial records, and other personal documents. And they can be fined, they can be ordered to pay attorney's fees, and summarily incarcerated if they refuse. Parents are regularly interrogated by state officials behind closed doors about intimate family matters. Fathers must submit to plethysmographs, where an electronic sheath is placed over the penis while the father is forced to watch pornographic films involving children. Parents' homes are routinely entered by government officials to determine fitness, even when fitness has not been questioned. And privileged consultations with therapists and family counselors and physicians can be demanded and examined. Okay. Family courts routinely use children as informers against their parents to monitor compliance with court orders and report on how they otherwise conduct their private lives. The Fifth Amendment, guarantee of due process of law, does not prevent family courts from jailing parents for weeks, months, or even years without trial. Courts also jail children who fail to cooperate with divorce proceedings. The presumption of innocence has been inverted. The defendant in a custody trial must, at his own expense, show not that he is innocent of wrongdoing, but that he's been a positively good parent, even when he's not been accused of being a bad one. So attorneys and lawyers demand and debate evidence even when it's not a pointed issue, probably to drive up the fees. Okay? And a parent who must also, if he wants to see his children, he must also amass evidence against his spouse, even if he doesn't wish to, in the spirit of a cockfight. Accusations of spousal abuse and child abuse made during divorce without any evidence are used to separate parents from their children and evict them from their homes. Here, too, the presumption of innocence is eliminated. According to a legal journal, the mere allegation of domestic abuse may shift the burden of proof to the defendant. And accusations known to be false, knowingly false, are almost never punished. Parents are routinely forced to sign pre-printed forms with scripted confessions in cases of alleged domestic violence, obviously contravening the prohibition on self-incrimination. Parents are ordered into solitary confinement by officials other than judges, and of course ordered into mental evaluations, much as they were in the Soviet Union. The Sixth Amendment stipulates that in all criminal prosecutions, the accused shall enjoy the right of a speedy and public trial by an impartial jury in the local district. Yet a custody trial will be held behind closed doors, and family courts do not record their proceedings. Ostensibly, this is to protect family privacy, but in fact, it has precisely the opposite effect. It provides a cloak with which family privacy to disguise the fact that family privacy is being invaded with impunity. And then the information coerced by family courts from the parents is then made available to anyone, including the media, where it can be used to defame or blackmail litigants who criticize the courts. Courts have been caught altering official transcripts and recordings and otherwise falsifying and fabricating evidence. This has been documented. Delays of months and years are common as the parent with temporary custody delays and tries to establish a status quo. Since the advent of no-fault divorce, parents can no longer demand a jury trial, with the result, in the words of one attorney, that the courts can now find the facts in a particular case to be whatever they wish them to be. In child support cases, parents can be jailed for extended periods of time without an attorney. And according to the National Conference of State Legislatures, the burden of proof may be shifted to the defendant here too. NCSL approves these measures and urges its members to use them, so its analysis is probably accurate. And they point out that the lines between civil and criminal contempt can be blurred, quote, particularly if the court does not explicitly clarify the charge facing the allegedly delinquent parent, okay? So just like Kafka's character Joseph K. in the novel The Trial, the parent may not even know the charge against which he must defend himself. Okay. And also, according to NCSL, not all child support cases are entitled to a jury trial, and not all defendants are entitled to a lawyer. Okay. So in short, a parent who has lost his children through literally no fault of his own must prove his innocence against an accusation that may not even be clearly defined, without an attorney and without a jury of his peers. Again, the Sixth Amendment, courts allow parents to be prosecuted and jailed in jurisdictions other than those where their alleged crime took place, even in jurisdictions where they've never set foot, contrary to the common law. Some parents are actually taken not before a judge at all, but before a black-robed lawyer known as a judge surrogate. These officials wield judicial powers as if they are judges, but their appointments are not confirmed by the legislature, so they're not answerable to the citizens or their representatives. In effect, they can become political activists in robes. And what is supposed to be impartial justice becomes the hijacking of the judiciary to implement a political agenda. And there's a lot of instances, examples of this. The Eighth Amendment prohibits cruel and unusual punishment. But this doesn't stop family courts from depriving parents of professional licenses, driver's licenses, passports, that have no connection with the alleged offense. Parents have their cars booted and their names published in the newspapers without actually being convicted of any offense. One campaign to embarrass deadbeat parents by displaying their names on billboards and pizza boxes, but ended up collecting nothing. The Ninth Amendment, recognition of certain rights not explicitly enumerated, has long been held to include a right of privacy and a right of parenthood, which has also been held by the case law to be protected by the 14th Amendment. Yet again, this case law is simply ignored by the courts. The 10th Amendment reserves rights for such as family law to state governments. Yet both child support and domestic violence have been effectively federalized through federal legislation and the creation of federal enforcement offices. Generally, Congress assumes control over local matters through the Interstate Commerce Clause, but it's not clear how child support enforcement or domestic violence or divorce, for that matter, has anything to do with interstate commerce. Parents are routinely ordered into employment and their wages are confiscated. Previously, this would have been considered contrary to the 13th Amendment prohibition on slavery and involuntary servitude, but recent court decisions have held otherwise. Originally, quote, Congress put it beyond debate that no indebtedness warrants a suspension of the right to be free from compulsory service, according to one federal ruling. No state can make the quitting of work or any component of a crime or make criminal sanctions available for holding unwilling persons to labor. Again, this has all been overturned by the divorce courts. Perhaps most obvious, the unilateral enforced divorce laws, which permit one partner to abrogate the marriage agreement without incurring any legal consequences. This is a clear and obvious violation of the contract clause of the Constitution, which says that no state shall pass any law impairing the obligation of contracts. I could go on and on about this. It's a constitutional disaster. Laws that are applied, because the no-fault divorce laws were applied to marriages that had been contracted under different laws and terms, they are effectively ex post facto laws, explicitly prohibited by the Constitution. Also ex post facto is the Child Support Recovery Act, which imposed criminal penalties on child support arrearages accrued before the passage of the act. Okay, the constitutional guarantee of habeas corpus is another clause that is simply ignored, since parents are held in jail for weeks or months or even years without charge or trial. Divorce is also at the forefront of enacting bills of attainder, or legislative declarations of guilt, also prohibited explicitly by the Constitution. These measures eliminate the presumption of innocence because they punish not crimes, but persons who are presumed without trial or conviction to have committed crimes. Okay, there's a number of examples of this I could go into, but I won't. The Elizabeth Morgan Act is the most notorious, whereby Congress legislatively separated father and child and branded, in the words of a federal court, as a criminal child abuser, a father against whom no evidence was ever presented in a court or elsewhere. Congress violated the constitutional prohibition against bills of attainder by singling out a plaintiff for legislative punishment. Okay. This was a textbook example of a bill of attainder, and yet it took the courts 6 years to act, during which time the damage was done. The daughter grew up permanently estranged from her father. The very fact that a bill of attainder is used at all indicates the truly extreme politicization of the criminal justice system. Bills of attainder are rare, draconian measures used for one purpose, to punish and convict political enemies who cannot be convicted through legal evidence. Okay. The child support system also overturned centuries of common law principle that a parent cannot be forced to pay for the stealing of his own children. And again, I could quote you the case law here. A father has a right at common law to maintain his children in his own home, says one ruling, and he cannot be compelled against his will to do so elsewhere unless he has refused or failed to provide for them where he lives. Family courts in the U.S. and other democracies routinely ignore international human rights conventions to which their governments are signatories, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, for example, or the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, which the U.S. has agreed, guarantees the rights of parents to raise their children as they see fit, and it guarantees the integrity of the family. So again, you could see, I could go on about this forever. It's unbelievable. It's as if the Constitution simply didn't exist. There's two innovations, though, in the divorce industry that merit special attention for what they've contributed to government power and to eroding Americans' constitutional rights. These are the domestic violence industry and the child support enforcement apparatus. Both are dishonest, and both are highly corrupt. Legal scholar David Heleniak describes domestic violence as, quote, an area of law mired in intellectual dishonesty and injustice. It is a backwater of tautological pseudo-theory and failed intervention programs, write to other scholars. No other area of established social welfare, criminal justice, public health, or behavioral intervention has such weak evidence in support of mandated practice. Okay. Unlike physical assault and other real crimes, domestic violence has no definition. Okay, it can be anything, including undermining, this is a quote, undermining an individual's sense of self-worth and or self-esteem, according to the federal government. Domestic violence can be physical, sexual, emotional, economic, or psychological actions or threats of actions that influence another person, according to the Department of Justice. Among the crimes in DOJ's definition of violence are constant criticism, diminishing one's abilities, and name-calling. In other words, it can mean anything. Anything that government officials want to punish. Okay, domestic violence is often defined not as physical assault, but as subjective fear. So that again, as with divorce itself, guilt is determined not by any objective act of the accused, but by the subjective state of mind of the accuser. But the essential thing to remember about domestic violence hysteria is that it is almost entirely connected with divorce and child custody. Law journals have repeatedly documented how false accusations are treated as true and used to separate parents from their children without any corroborating evidence. But it's very clear, actually, even if you just look at the literature on domestic violence itself, okay, which is obsessed with child custody. After all, if physical violence was the problem, one would expect that the principal concern would be that men are beating their wives and not being prosecuted, with custody as a secondary matter. If duly convicted criminals are incarcerated, after all, custody shouldn't be an issue. Instead, the literature on domestic violence is dominated by the complaints not that allegedly violent assailants are avoiding prison and walking the streets, but that they're allowed to see their children after involuntary divorce. Okay? Okay. So pointed is this complaint that custody rather than safety is the principal grievance concerning parents who are being portrayed as violent criminals. Okay. All this confirms that most of these batterers have not battered anyone, and that the entire affair is a ploy to win advantage in divorce court. And by the way, this idea of accusations, false accusations, this is spreading out into other areas of our society, as we've seen in recent months with the Kavanaugh hearings and many other areas where public officials have been accused of these things. So it's not far-fetched at all to suggest that the Me Too ploy, the Me Too tactics and method, modus operandi, was pioneered in the divorce courts. I think it's very easy to make that case. Restraining orders are another radical legal innovation. They don't punish criminals for illegal acts they are proven to have committed. Instead, they punish law-abiding citizens for otherwise legal acts. Judges can simply legislate new crimes with a stroke of a pen. And there's a number of legal cases I could cite on this by Jeannie Suk and other legal scholars. Okay, it's only a crime, though, for the recipient of the order, who can then be arrested for doing what no statute prohibits and what the rest of us can do without penalty. Okay, so a parent under a restraining order becomes, quote, the only man in the world who is specifically prevented by law from seeing his children. This is a line from a law journal. Because violent assault and other crimes are already illegal, The protective order doesn't actually protect anybody. The only people restrained from anything are peaceful, law-abiding citizens who are prohibited from seeing their children. So thus, restraining orders codify the presumption of guilt that are begun with the divorce decree and with the custody order. So you can see the logic that's going on here. First of all, the unilateral divorce allows you to get rid of your spouse. And then the custody decree allows you to keep the spouse away from the children. But what if the spouse sees the children in the shopping mall or at the baseball game? Or so, you know, you've got to prohibit that too somehow. So that's the reason for the domestic violence accusation and the restraining order. So the logic flows just naturally from the divorce system. But the most diabolical feature of all in the government's divorce apparatus is the child support system, an engine for creating maximum divorce using the most repressive government machinery ever seen in America. And I maintain, if you know anybody who doesn't believe in a personal devil, just explain to them how the child support system works. It's too diabolical to have been come about by accident. Bryce Christensen writes that the advocates of ever more aggressive measures for collecting child support have moved us a dangerous step closer to a police state and have violated the rights of innocent and often impoverished fathers. Okay. Contrary to popular belief and centuries of, again, common law precedent, child support today has nothing to do with fathers abandoning their children, reneging on their marital vows, or even agreeing to a divorce. It is automatically assessed on all non-custodial parents, even those divorced over their objections without grounds. Okay, so like divorce and child custody, in other words, it has nothing to do with justice. Yet the enforcement machinery is highly punitive. Author and attorney Jade Abraham describes it as a veritable gulag, complete with sophisticated surveillance and compliance capabilities such as computer-based tracing, license revocation, asset confiscation, and incarceration. The face of this regime, he writes, is decidedly Orwellian. So in short, child support is no longer a method for requiring men to take responsibility for the offspring they have sired and then abandoned, as most people are led to believe. It's a regime whereby, as Abraham says, a father is forced to finance the filching of his own children. It incentivizes divorce, and it turns children into cash prizes. Like no-fault divorce itself, the initiative for this mobilization came entirely from government officials. No public outcry ever preceded these measures, nor did any public perception of a problem even exist until the government officials began saying it did. The public never demanded that the government take action. No public discussion has ever been held on this problem in the media or anywhere else. No government or academic study ever showed a non-payment problem. So the initiative has been taken, as with divorce, throughout by government officials and quasi-governmental interest groups who increase both their power and their earnings as a result. It's very clear now that the entire matter also is largely a hoax, and that what is being portrayed as irresponsible parents is in fact a massive abuse of power by the state. Child support is the only financial obligation or debt that most of the debtors have done nothing to fear, nothing to incur. Economist William Kominer writes that child support obligations are now treated far more harshly than any other form of debt. And attorney Ron Henry calls it an obvious sham, the most onerous form of debt collection practiced in the United States. Research by Kominer and Sanford Braver and others has undermined every justification for the multi-billion dollar enforcement machinery, including the programs to promote responsible fatherhood, which were fashionable a few years ago. So if these scholars are to be believed, and no one has refuted them, the government is whipping up hysteria against innocent people and engaging in a massive witch hunt. Yet no government agency has ever acknowledged this research by reputable scholars, and no government agency has ever modified their policies as a result. The government machinery was created not following claims of child support non-payment, but before. In other words, it was less a response to deadbeat dads than a mechanism for creating them. Like no-fault divorce itself, and shortly after no-fault divorce was enacted, the child support regulations and enforcement machinery were created largely when no one was paying attention. Like welfare, child support creates a huge incentive for divorce. And I could quote you numerous scholars here who say this, quote, an incentive for divorce by the custodial mother. Robert Willis, an economist, estimates that 1/5 to 1/3 of child support payments actually go for the children. The rest is profit for the parent, which, of course, provides a huge incentive to divorce for profit. So, in other words, one parent can simply escape the uncertainties and compromises necessary to a life with a spouse, by divorcing, whereupon that parent acquires the police as a private collection agency, a huge windfall of tax-free income that he or she alone controls. So Christensen and others point out very clearly the result of link between the the child support enforcement and the erosion of wedlock. Okay, these scholars diplomatically suggest that these effects are unintentional, but this is not likely. Child support set at onerous levels has three main benefits for government officials. The higher the support payments, the more mothers are incentivized to divorce. This creates more business for the judges, lawyers, and others. High payments bring more federal tax dollars to government coffers, which are used to pay court's expenses and augment salaries. Okay? And third, onerous payments criminalize more fathers, which justify higher budgets and salaries for enforcement officials. So not surprisingly, the whole system is riddled with conflicts of interest and corruption. Guidelines are set not by by legislators, but by enforcement officials, an obvious conflict of interest and a violation of the separation of powers. Judges who benefit from high child support payments can order parents to pay almost any amount by simply adding on things which were supposed to be considered already in the initial calculation. So by shifting blame, in short, by shifting blame from the parent who violates a legal contract to the deserted parent's concocted financial obligation, a parent whose spouse walks out without any legal grounds is liable to arrest if he can't afford horseback riding lessons. Okay. So in closing, I want to point out that simply by ignoring the elementary principles of justice, the child support regime, and with it really the entire divorce regime itself, comes to resemble a kind of absurdistan. This is the name that the dissidents of Eastern Europe gave to the communist dictatorships, not so much for their brutality as for their buffoonery. And I'll give you a few examples in parting. Child support can be collected not only from parents, but from almost anyone. Men who are not fathers, second wives, grandparents, even children can find their bank accounts emptied by enforcement officials. West Virginia cleaned out the bank account of an 85-year-old grandmother and even charged her $75 processing fee. Men are forced to pay child support for children who are not theirs and even for children who never existed. Multiple adults, such as step-parents, pay child support for the same children, making it possible to multiple marriages to obtain multiple child support proceeds from multiple men without the inconvenience of multiple children. Runaway children can sue their own parents for child support. Grown men in their 50s can sue their parents for child support. We've got 40 and 45-year-old kids running around who are owed child support, says the Virginia director. Children who are supposed to receive child support end up having to pay it. And I've got cases of this. Even children who are raped by adults must pay child support to the criminals who raped them. And this includes children who were drugged before the sexual act. Of course, this violates the ancient principle of the common law that criminals should not profit for their crimes. So child support corrupts not only the public, our government, but it also corrupts our private morals. One girl tells a Toronto newspaper of her savvy career plans. "I'm going to marry a really rich guy," she says, "then divorce him. But first, I'm going to have his kids, so I get child support." Okay, so children become even cash crops. Speaking of communist dictatorships, the survivors of both communist and Nazi regimes readily perceive the similarity with American family courts. Bogomila and Jerzy Kos compared New York's family courts to the bureaucratic tyrannies they knew in Poland. Quote, "As children, we lived through Nazi horror, then through communist occupation," they write. "And now in the United States, the land of the free, we are persecuted by judicial tyranny." But, and this is an important difference, while the Nazis and Stalinist regimes used children as one weapon among many, today in the Western democracies, children and families have become the central targets, and parents, rather than dissidents, are arrested. After experiencing American family law, Romanian dissident Muhai Muset gained a new perspective on the totalitarian justice in Nicolae Ceaușescu's communist Romania, the regime he'd been arrested by. He writes, "I was sentenced to 2 months in prison," he recalled, "but at least I got to appear in court and talk to a judge. That's more than I got in family court." So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Steve. Thank you. All right. Our next speaker, before I bring up our next speaker, I just want to show everybody that Dr. Baskerville has two books back here. His recent one is The New Politics of Sex, And his book, Taken into Custody, is his first and important work on the subject of the that he discussed here. So be sure to get those at the break and to take a look at it. I know he's already autographed a few of these books. And also my book, The Sexual State, was in part based on some of the things that Steve talked about. So.